Open up your Bibles. Who's ready for tonight? First, we're going to open up our Bibles to Romans chapter 12. We're continuing our series. We like to talk in series. We're hoping that if you're new here, we first off welcome you. Man, we're glad you came out. I think it's very cool. It's very easy to recognize new people, so you're probably feeling a little embarrassed. I'm not going to make you stand up or anything. I'm Nate. I'm one of the youth pastors here. We've got actually my wife. She was the offering lady. That's my wife. She's amazing. Next Wednesday, I get to preach First Wednesday. Hey. So we want to remind you to come out to First Wednesday. Sometimes people are like, well, that's a night I missed youth. No. That's a nice night you get to church. And we're even going to start kind of things, this thing called Wednesdays Matter. And we're going to talk more about that. But we want you here. When you're not here, it matters. When you personally, I'm talking to you, sometimes people are like, well, no, we just care about youth church in general. No. When you're not here, we miss you. And you bring something to the table. So we always want to make sure that you get here. Make sure that your friends get here. And it's going to be a good time. So we're going to continue this series on insecurity. So insecurity is a big deal. Who likes being insecure? I tricked you on that one. How many of you guys have noticed an insecurity about your life as we have talked about this? Come on. You're like, I'm too insecure to raise my hand. like, who has noticed something like, okay, I'm kind of insecure about that, honestly. Come on. Anybody? Awesome. So this is a big deal. Adults are insecure, okay? And so what were the hopes of this topic, the hopes of this is I want us walking into rooms confident, not because of our sports, not because of our talents, not because of that we're good looking or ugly or whatever, you know, like not because we're the class clown, not because of anything else other than God loves me and I'm okay. Does that make sense? Because so many times we put our lives, we build our lives on something other than Jesus. And guess what? If you're all building your life on your good looks, one day you're gonna get wrinkly. I got a wrinkle coming in like right here. I was like, what is that? It was a wrinkle. It's coming in. I just got to stretch my face and it doesn't. It did cross my mind. Thanks, Paige. Appreciate it. Wow. Junior hire is like, hey, youth pastor, you need a facelift. Then I'll come in like, what's up, everybody? It's perfect. It's like, you look so beautiful. One time somebody came up to me, Paige, asked me, said, did you hit your nose? You bumped your nose? I said, no, that's my nose. It's bumpy in the top. Wow. I hope you don't tell her that. Okay. Paige, we'll talk later, okay? All right, open up your Bibles. Two. So we're talking about insecurities. And guys, this is a big deal. Okay, here we go. Romans. Where do we go from there? Okay, the title of tonight's message is Don't Get a Facelift. Okay, just joking. It's not. Romans, verse 1 says, I beseech you, therefore, brethren, Romans 12, 1 says, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. What does that mean? That means I'm going to give God everything. He's got my whole everything. Present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable, which is your reasonable service. God died for you. It's only makes sense that you give your whole life to him. And therefore, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That means changing of your thinking. You change the way you think. We don't want to think like the world. We want to think differently, right? That you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Verse 3. So for I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly. So we are not to think higher of ourselves than we should, but we're supposed to think soberly. That means like even-minded. That you should think, so as God has dealt each one a measure. We're going to jump down to verse 16. But be of the same mind toward one another. Do not set your mind on high things. I'm so cool. I'm the best. I'm amazing. I'm kind of a big deal. Hashtag I'm cool. Do not set your mind on high things, but associate with the humble. I'm asking you tonight, do you associate with the humble? You see the kid sitting by himself, can you go sit with him? Or are you too cool? The kid who stinks. The kid who's smelly.
the kid who's weird. Maybe you're the weird kid. People are like, I wish somebody would sit with me. You're like, okay, I'm talking to you tonight. Do you associate with the humble? Or are you too stuck up, too cool for school? Keep going. Do not be wise in your own opinion. Do not be awesome in your own opinion. Tonight, oh my God, one more verse. Proverbs. I love this. Proverbs 26, verse 12. It says, do you see a man wise in his own eyes? That means, I am awesome. Look what the Bible says about that guy. There's more hope for a fool than for him. I'm going to say that again because you guys weren't paying attention. Do you see a man wise in his own eyes? There's more hope for a fool than for him. You see the person who thinks, man, I am something else. I am amazing. The title of tonight's message is, I'm not that cool. Everybody's going to say that one with me. On your mark, get set. Title of the message is? Okay, I want you to like thumb yourself when you guys do that. On your mark, get set. I'm not that cool. Some of you guys pointed to your friend. You're like, you're not that cool. Okay, let's do that again. I'm not that cool. One, two, three. I'm not that cool. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the word. Help me preach. Help them listen. I pray that we would walk in humility, walk right, walk the way we're supposed to, and we would see ourselves in you and only in you. We thank you for it. In Jesus' name, everybody said. Who is a fashion person in here? Jordan Boyer is a fashion person. I know that. She's so cool. Cece, are you a fashion person? You don't know. You definitely are a fashion. Who cares about the clothes they wear? They're like, Johnny, actually, you match a lot of times. That's awesome. Sometimes boys need a little more help than others. But I've always been a fashion guy. You know, I've always liked the way I look. I've always, like, thought about it. I like to, if people ask me, like, you like to shop or you like to go out in the woods or something, I'd be like, when are we going shopping? You know, like that was just me. But we never had really that much money. You know, anybody can relate. So, you just get like the best brand of Payless shoes at Payless. You know, we didn't get like DC shoes because DCs were expensive. I was a skate guy, but I got like the knockoff DCs. My sister, true story, my sister had a really cool outfit. It was like corduroys. I know, whatever. It was corduroys and it was like a skate shirt, skateboarding, and she had real Airwalks. And every once in a while, on a special day, I got to wear all of her stuff. I don't know why me and my sister shared stuff. Kind of awkward, true story. But listen to me very closely. I'm getting it somewhere. And I would walk in. I thought you were like pouring water, Paige. I was like, you and your aunt need to stop, okay? Pay attention, Paige. I'm getting somewhere with my corduroys and Airwalks. Okay, so I'm walking in and I would be like, what's up? Yeah, these are Airwalks. Yep, what's up? And I would only wear like once every like 3 months because my sister was really mean and wouldn't let me like wear her stuff on like a field trip day or like something special where I wanted to look extra cool. And I was thinking to myself, everybody is looking at me right now. You know what's so funny is when you're a young person, listen to me very closely, when you're a young person, you actually think that's true. You literally think everybody's thinking about my outfit, how cool I am, how amazing I am. Anybody ever get a brand new outfit and you walk in like, what's up? What's up? What's up? Yeah, I look good right now. My outfit's on point right now. And you think everybody's looking at you. This is pride. This is, the Bible says, don't think of yourself more highly than you ought, but think about yourself. And girls, I'm gonna attack this. Get ready. You ready? I'm talking about the selfie generation. I'm talking about the right angle generation, making sure you got like 20 other selfies that you did not post that were kind of ugly, and then you got just the right one to make sure you look good. Click on that post. And then if it gets enough likes, you leave it. But if it don't get enough likes, you realize it wasn't that good because they didn't like you enough, and so you take it off real quick. Get another angle. Click. We're talking a selfie generation. Back in my day, I didn't have a cell phone, but I walked through the hallways hoping that they look at us. Now we have a cell phone, so we get to shove our face into their social media and hope that they enjoy us and hope that they look at us and hope they like us. And if we get a photo that has a lot of likes, we are validated. They have done studies on this that we literally, dopamine in your brain fires off when you have a little heart in your Instagram page. Dopamine. We're talking the same stuff that is connected to drugs. Dopamine makes me feel good when you like my page. And we're addicted. We got to be better than that. Does it really? Now look at me. I want everybody to look at me. And I'm not picking on anybody. I find myself even addicted to social media. Looking, wondering what you're missing out on. Is our worth really connected to how many hearts we have on Instagram? Like, really? How many followers we have? How many people comment and like us? Are we waiting for somebody to validate us? Or do we know that God has already validated us and we're already okay? So tonight, you're not that cool. That's what I'm talking about. I'm not that cool. We're not that cool. I remember my dad got a Yamaha motorcycle. Okay, and this was, and guys, I wish I could tell you I was like 7 years old or something, but I wasn't, okay? I was old, I was married. Maybe I wasn't married yet. I wasn't married yet, so I was like 19. And he had got a Yamaha. Now listen to me very closely. Yamahas are horrible, by the way. I had a Harley, I had a Yamaha. I mean, I've driven on a Yamaha. I know the difference, and Harleys are 1,000 times better. I'm not just saying that, just preference. They really are. They're more expensive. They sound better. And I'm just saying that, just being honest, I ran both motorcycles. I even had a Honda for a little bit. Harleys, quality-wise, it's just really no comparison. You even put it on, you put some pipes on a Yamaha, it kind of sounds like, it just doesn't sound good. It sounds like it just sounds bad. But listen to me very closely. It was carbureted. Carbureted means you need to rev it up and it gets like warmed up and whatever. So it was cool and that. And I thought I was so cool riding around on my father's motorcycle. Driving out of the parking lot, driving. Oh, you see like people on the side of the road. You're like, yeah, look at me. I'm cool. And listen to me. I bet you a lot of 90% of those people, I drove by and they're like, man, that bike's annoying. Or man, what is, like, why does he rev his engine? Why is he driving so fast? They thought tons of other things, none of which they thought, man, that guy is so cool. But I wanted their validation. And I'm telling on myself to say I wasn't that cool, but I thought I was. And that somehow by them looking at me, they're probably looking at me like, slow down, like moron, you know? But just because they got their attention, I feel I'm okay. I'm good. And it's insecurity. It really is. I see the Harley guys now, and I got a Harley, and I went through the same thing. We've talked about that. But I remember thinking, like, that's a Yamaha. And it didn't take much for me to think I'm cool. Some of y'all riding around on your bicycle, like, just right, like, just riding around like, yeah, look at me, I got my bicycle. I mean, whatever you're getting in pride about. And what it is it's really insecurity. You get a new outfit, you get a new skateboard, you get a new scooter, whatever you think is cool. And the problem is you're not that cool. We are not that cool. And I'm not gonna, like, I don't wanna like bash on us tonight. I'm not trying to be like, what'd you get out of youth tonight? He just told me I wasn't that cool, like all night long, like a bunch of times actually. Like, yeah, and he actually made me repeat it a couple of times, like, I am not cool. Like, and I say that because none of us are cool. We are just, anything good in our lives is because of Jesus. Anything we have is because of Jesus. He gave us our looks. Some of you guys are like, thanks, Jesus. Like, but no, like, he gave us our looks. He gave us anything good that we have is because of Jesus. Anything bad we have, that's us. And that's not like a weird statement. That is the true, walking in humility is walking in reality. Walking in truth. Walking in, like, I am, man, if I'm good at sports, God gave me that ability. If I'm really good at math, God gave me that ability. Man, if I can talk to people, if I have good looks, What did you do for your good looks? How much did you work to get the nose you got? None. Yet why do you glory as if you got it on your own? And what happens when your beauty fades? Does your value fade? You see what I'm saying? And we get weird. We get wrapped up. And listen, our society, that's why Romans says, do not be conformed to this world. Don't think like the world thinks. My beauty is not outwardly. My beauty is within. And that's something we really have to grasp. My confidence isn't in my clothing. My confidence is in Christ. I walk into a room not because I have the good clothes on or the good, and I'm confident. I can look you in the eye as they ask you how you're doing. I can actually care about other people, not because I'm so cool, but because God is big in me. Listen to me very closely. I believe I'm saying this by the Spirit of God. This world, this generation does not need more selfie generation young people. We need to get off of ourselves and onto other people. We need to quit waiting for our validation from other people and start giving other people their own validation. Being able to say, man, you're amazing. Man, you're phenomenal. Man, I love the way you play sports. Being confident in our own self so that we can encourage other people. That's confidence. That's what we want. Being able to go in and say, man, you're amazing. Man, I love watching you do that. Man, you did that so awesome. Man, you're so talented in that. Man, you are good looking, man. Rather than waiting, I hope they tell me that I'm good looking. I hope anybody likes me. I hope I'm okay. And guys, listen, and it's so easy. And guys, I wish I was your parent, you know, every one of you from the time you were little and a week, I got the chance to tell you how cool you are. Every one of you guys are amazing. But you're amazing because God, that's the way God made you. Every one of you are phenomenal. You are cool. But it's not cool in your own might. It's not cool because you're trying. It's cool because God made you very unique and very special. We glory not in ourselves. We glory in God. We don't wait for somebody to tell us that we're cool. God's already told you that you're fearfully and wonderfully made. You're perfect just the way God made you. And I want tonight... I want us to be able to look at ourselves and say, is there any insecurity in our lives? Am I doing, and I remember, you ever like get your hair, like do your hair just perfect, you know, do everything just right, and you like walk out into the world, you're like, yeah, I'm the coolest thing since sliced bread. You're like, what's up? And you like spend the whole day, and you're like, and again, I wish I could tell you I did this when I was like 7 or 6 or 5, maybe I was 25, okay? And maybe I was like, maybe it was last week. And like, I have this blue hair gel. It's blue. It's really cool, and it sticks the best. It's called Woody's. That's what it's called. It's just like a blue hair gel. It's really awesome, right? It's hard to find. My sister finds it for me. Anyway, so I put it in my hair from time to time, Jackson. And I walk around like, what's up? Good to see you. And I spend the whole day, I kid you, maybe I go to a wedding, maybe I'm like, hey, what's up? I'm like encouraging other people, like, how, man, I look good today, so I'm gonna encourage you, because you need it. You don't got this right now. I got this, but you need encouragement. And then I get home, I'm like, and there's a big chunk of blue in my hair that I didn't like brush in. And I was like, all day long. Nobody told me. Nobody's like, is this some blue in your hair? And it's not like black. It's not like white. It's like blue. It's clearly blue. And I'm like, nobody held me out. Why? Because I'm not that cool. You're not that cool. You know what I'm talking about. About halfway through your day, you get to lunch, you look in the mirror, you got toothpaste on your mouth. You're like, oh my gosh, I was walking around first period, second period, third period with toothpaste in my mouth. Nobody told me. Nobody would be like, are you foaming of the mouth? Are you frothing? Do you have rabies? But no, I just brushed my teeth in the morning. You didn't tell me. Because we're not that cool. We're not that cool. And I'm talking specifically about when you think you look good. And all of a sudden you find yourself, oh, I didn't look that good. Okay, true story. You ready for another true story? I'm telling on myself because I want you to realize that we are all in this together. I was a skateboarder, CC. I was really good, actually. I was pretty good. I could ollie over trash can. I could kickflip. I could 180 kickflip. I actually even 360 kickflip one time. I was okay. So my bride to be, my girlfriend, she's walking up the aisle. She's walking up like this. We were having a church picnic, and I was jumping like 4 or 5 stairs. It was a pretty good step, and I was jumping them. I was alling off of them and landing. I was like skating off into the abyss, and I was so cool because I wanted my value to be in my cool skateboarding, right? I wanted everybody to, when I ollied off these stairs, them to be like, oh my gosh, Nate, you are so amazing. You're so cool, and I can't do that, so you are unique and amazing, right? I'm getting my validation again through my skateboarding. Here she is. She's walking up the aisle. Walking up the sidewalk. I decide this is the perfect time to show off my skills. I put my skateboard down. I'm goofy. So I jump, poof, land. Look, eye contact the whole time, eye contact. And then, I hit a rock. I kid you not. If you've ever hit a rock on a skateboard, you hit a rock and instantly you're stopping. Your skateboard will stop. You will keep moving. And literally it was like, and I'm like, tumble, tumble, tumble. And so instead of the response of, oh man, Nate, you're amazing, it was, Nate, are you okay? Like, I get up like, I'm good. I'm so cool. Look at, yeah, doesn't even hurt. That bleeding doesn't even hurt. I'm not that cool. We're not that cool. I wanna challenge you tonight. Pride is an ugly thing. And listen to me. I was telling the leadership, I can't sit here and like tell you, Jackson, don't be prideful. You know, Pay, don't be prideful. Be humble. Don't be prideful. Like, you're gonna go away and be like, okay, I'll try not to be. Like, how do I even? Exactly. Listen to me very closely. Everybody eyes on me. Pride is deceptive. That's why what's really neat about this is I can look at the course of my life when I was younger and be like, oh my gosh, what was I thinking? Some of you guys are close. You can look back on old pictures and your old hairstyles and you're like, what was I thinking? How many guys can be like, honestly, like, man, I went through an ugly hat phase. Like, what was that about? Like, what? Nobody told me, like, go take a shower? Like, who was helping you? See, and you can relate a little bit. Listen to me. It's the same thing in 10 years from now. You're like, oh my gosh, I would walk in thinking I was the man. Like, why would I do that? And like, why didn't somebody like pull me aside? Like, hey, you're in church inside out, bro. Like, nobody help me. You got like blue in your hair. Why didn't somebody help me? So you're not going to be able to see this right away. You really won't. But the thing to look for is anytime, write this down. I hope you're taking notes. Anytime you're soliciting attention. Girls, anytime you're soliciting attention. What does that mean? Anytime you are hunting for somebody to look at you and say, that's amazing. That's pride. I know that that's an ugly thing because listen, our world totally does it. Like you can look at girls' pages and you wonder, like, do they do anything else besides take selfies? Like, do they ever see anything else besides themselves? Like, it's amazing. Like, dude, and I haven't looked at anybody's pages, so I'm not thinking of anybody in this room. So please help. If that's your page, I love you, and we're growing together, okay? we're going to get better together. So what I mean by that is if anytime you're doing what I've done, and I'm telling on myself because we're all in this together, you're getting on a motorcycle, and obviously maybe, but you're wanting somebody to go, wow, you're awesome. You're soliciting attention. We know that's pride. Okay? And now listen to me very closely. God doesn't like pride. And I'm gonna prove it to you through the Word of God. There's quite a bit of scriptures on pride. And I'm just going to read through a few of them just so that we kind of get just some understanding of this. So there's 28 of these references in Proverbs alone on pride. 28, and that's just in one book, okay? Lots of stories. Okay, so write these down, just listen to them, pay attention to them. We know that God hates pride, and we want to hate pride because pride is security in ourselves. We want our security in Christ, okay? Proverbs 11:2 says, when pride comes, then comes shame. How many of you guys know when I was jumping off that thing, I thought I was amazing, and then came shame. I was like, I suck, I'm the worst, okay? Proverbs 13:10 says, by pride, nothing comes but strife. When the well-advised is wisdom. Proverbs 16, verse 18. Pride goes before destruction. Man, I'm so cool. No, you ain't. Sit down. Pride goes before, and a haughty spirit before fall. Proverbs 21, verse 24, a proud and haughty man, scoffer is his name. He acts with arrogant pride. Proverbs 29, 23, a man's pride. Now listen to me, sometimes people tell you, like, you need to have pride. You need to be proud. Proud of who you are. Proud of your country. Proud of you. No. That kind of pride, a little different. We're talking about, we want people to be impressed with us. I heard it this way. Be impressive. Don't try to impress. You kill it on the football team. Kill it in the soccer. Be impressive. Do amazing job in your sports. But don't go out there like, hey, did you see that one? You see, do you need a replay? You need a slow-mo? Video this. Instagram this. Did you snap it? Show me. What is that? You are hoping somebody likes you. You need validation. And guys, I want to encourage you in this way. We don't want to be that way. Anybody want to be vain? Guys, there's 50-year-old adults that don't have this down yet. I've seen them on their motorcycles. I've seen them playing their music outside their car with their windows down. With their back seat loaded, a little down, so they can barely see him. I want to tap on the window. I'm going to do this one day. Maybe. I'll be like, hey, I see you. You're cool. You're all right. I really want to do that. Like, you're all right, bro. I like you. You're so cool. Anyway, sorry. Keep going. Verse 29-23. A man's pride will bring him low. A man's pride will bring him low, but a humble spirit will retain honor. You guys doing okay? Look at this, Proverbs 8:13. Can you guys notice that maybe God has a couple things to say about pride? Keep going. Proverbs 8:13 says, the fear of the Lord is to hate evil, pride, arrogance, and the evil way. And the perverse mouth I hate. Listen, God said, if you're gonna fear God, you're gonna hate this, and you gotta hate pride. And listen to me, you don't look for it in other people, you look for it in yourself. And listen, we're gonna pray this in just a second. You're not gonna see it all right away. You're not gonna go home and you know what? I'm gonna be pride free. I'm gonna be pride free. I'm gonna take a quick selfie and tell everybody I'm pride free. That's not how it works. You just fell into it right then. So this is something we work on all of our life. You get a new car, it's really tempting to be like, this is the car. This is the car. This car is the car of all cars. And you're gonna hate it in 6 months, but it's okay. But as you get your car, I am so cool. And it doesn't mean that you have to be excited about yourself, but it does mean that you don't wanna solicit attention. You wanna be humble in it. How can you get a new car and be humble about it? You can be good at something and be humble about it, okay? It's walking in reality, walking in truth. Keep going. Proverbs 26:12, I'm gonna read it again. We read this already, look. It says, do you see a man wise in his own eyes? There's more hope for a fool than him. That's good. Look at this. Before destruction, the heart of a man is haughty. That's kind of another way of saying pride goes before a fall. But look at this. But before honor is humility. I'm gonna close it up with this, guys. Listen to me. How many of you guys wanna walk in more goodness? How many of you guys wanna get better at things? How many of you guys want God's help more? I'm gonna give you a key right now. Go to James. James. Actually. James 4. The ability, listen to me, everybody, eyes on me. Look at me, I need you to focus and I need you to I know I do sound like a teacher right now. But I want you to get this. Grace is the ability to do something that you could not do on your own naturally. Okay? That's grace. A lot of you guys are working on you guys have graces from the beginning, from your birth. If you can draw, that's a grace. You didn't do anything to get that. You know what I mean? God, if you can sing, that's a grace. If you can hear a note and it sounds okay, that's a grace. If you can drum, that's definitely a grace. Who wants to be a drummer? You know what I'm saying? That's a grace. God gave you that ability, okay? You can grow in grace. You can get more grace. I want more grace, don't you? I want more ability, don't you? How do I get it? James 4, verse 6. But he gives more grace.
What? More grace?
Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble.
How am I going to get more grace? How am I going to get more grace?
I'm going to walk in humility. How am I going to walk in humility? I'm going to walk in the reality of what God's given. I'm not going to think myself more highly than I should. I'm going to think in what God called me to do. So how do I really do this in real time? Autumn's good at drumming. Somebody comes up to Autumn and says, man, Autumn, you are phenomenal at drumming. And she is. That's when she says, thanks so much, man. God's good. God's faithful. Man, I just give all the glory to God. And she's not trying to be humble. Oh, yeah, Pastor Nate says I'm supposed to glory in the grace. Okay. Yep, thank God. No. Autumn realizes and completely understands that without God, she could not drum. Yes, I put some time in, but man, God gives me my time. And if it wasn't for God, I couldn't drum. That's how you receive a compliment. That's how you really understand what God's given you. That's how you do it in reality. The reality is if God removed Autumn's grace from her life, she'd sit behind those drums and be like, how do I do this again? That's reality. That's reality, and that's humility. And guys, listen to me. Jackson, I want you to be phenomenal. How are you going to get there? Humility. I want you guys to be better and better at whatever your sport or whatever activity. I want you amazing at it. Well, how do we get it? We get more grace. We walk in more grace. How are we going to walk in more grace? Walking in humility. Amen? Amen? Look at me real quick. Eyes on me, and we're going to say this together. Say, I do not walk in pride. I walk in humility. Say this a bit boldly. Say, God, give me grace. Help me see. I don't want to be blinded. I don't want to be stupid. I don't want to be prideful. Open my eyes. Mean this with all your heart. Say, show me pride in my life. Show me pride in this selfie generation. It's not about me. It's all about you. I love you. Talk to you later. In Jesus' name, amen. Let me pray over you, guys. Now listen to me very closely. I believe in you. And guys, every stand up with me, there's some big deficits in our life. How many of you guys know that, right? I wish my mom and dad, they hugged me more. I wish my dad was more encouraging. I wish my mom, you know, would have put me in jujitsu sooner. Like, thanks, Mom. I could have been a black belt by now. We can all play the game of woulda, coulda, shoulda, wish. You know what I mean? But we don't. We got the cards dealt with us. And some of you guys are 12 years old. You're at the age of accountability. Jordan, actually, can I get you to play for a second? And then what does that mean? That means now you're responsible for the word that you're hearing. You're going to leave this place. Jordan's going to come up and play. It makes me sound really spiritual. You're going to leave this place, and tomorrow you get to go to school. And girls, now listen to me. We don't change this. This isn't an idea of like, okay, now I'm not going to do my hair anymore because who cares? It's not about me. It's about Jesus. And then like, I'm not wearing deodorant anymore because it's about Jesus. It's not about me. It's about Jesus. You smelling that? That's Jesus coming through right now. Like, no, please. You're from another church. If that's you, you're from another church. I don't know what other church, but not from here. You don't say you're from New Creation Church. That doesn't mean you don't care about yourself. It says in Hebrews, ladies, don't just adorn yourself. It doesn't say don't adorn yourself. It says don't make that your primary. Don't make that your focus. Yes, man, I'm going to do my hair. I'm going to look good. I still enjoy shopping. I like shopping. But I'm not walking in going to be like, look at my, man, I feel good because I look good. No. I just like shopping. It doesn't make or break me. It doesn't give me my value. Doesn't just because my outfit looks clean or whatever doesn't mean that I now know that you think I'm okay. My confidence is in him and him alone, not my selfies. And guys, we can get this. We can stand out. Why? Because I want to help people. I want to come up to people and be like, man, you're amazing. You're phenomenal. You're going to make it. And guys, when was the last time you had an encouraging word from a young person your age? When was the last time you got an encouraging word from somebody your age? It's rare, isn't it? When was the last time somebody made fun of you? like today, like right now, the kid sitting next to me made fun of me. Said my BO stinks. He says your Jesus is beginning to stink. Right? We get made fun of a lot. You know why? Bullying is a sheer sign of insecurity. I got to push you low so I look better. And guys, we don't need a bully generation. We don't need a selfie generation. We need a generation of young people that are bold and confident, confident in who they are, can go up somebody and encourage them without any kind of waiting. Like, I encourage you. No, like me back. No, I love people and I'm going to encourage people. Amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I want to give everybody an opportunity tonight. The first step of humility is surrendering your life to Jesus. We read it in Romans. It says, offer up your whole entire life to Christ. And if you've never done that, this is the most important humility decision. It's recognizing I cannot save myself. I need Jesus. It's recognizing I am nowhere without myself. I need Jesus. And this is one of the most important. It's called getting saved. It's called getting born again. It's called giving up your life. I cannot get to heaven on my own. I need a Savior. If you've never done that, I want to give you that opportunity. We're believing God that every single week, your friends are coming in this place, people who are coming in this place, and ultimately, this is the number that matters, is people giving their life to Jesus. So if you're in here, and right now, maybe your heart's pounding, you're like, yeah, I've never done that. I've never humbled myself and said, I need Jesus. It's a super simple prayer. We're all going to say it in just a second, but if you've never done that, I want to give you the opportunity, and I want you to be bold enough to raise your hand. I'm not going to call you up, not going to embarrass you, but I want you just out of your own heart to be able to purposely say, yeah, I need Jesus. That's a humility. That's a mark of humility. You say, man, I need Jesus in my life. I want to live for him. I want to become a Jesus follower. On the count of three, one. Come on. This is your day, young person. You can't make it without him. Two, he loves you. He has a plan for your life. Three, right now, shoot your hand up. Say, yeah, I want to be a Jesus follower. And you've never done that before. Maybe you've done that before. Some of you guys are putting up your hand. You put up your hand and you say, man, I want to become a Jesus follower. And I've never done that before. All right, I see that hand. I see it. All right, I'm going to give you one more second. If that's you, put it up and put it right back down. I want to be a Jesus follower. I want to serve him all the days of my life. All right, see that hand. Oh, I want everybody to look at me. I want to say this prayer, okay? And if you're saying this prayer for the first time, this is all the Bible says is really clear. Confess with your mouth, believe in your heart. That's it. So what we're doing is we're confessing, and the believing part, that's up to you. So say this to me if you feel comfortable. Say, Father God, I believe in my heart. I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord. I'm humble enough to notice that. I can't do this on my own. I need him to go to heaven, to wash my sin, and I want to live for him all the days of my life. I love him. I love you. Talk to you later. In Jesus' name, amen. Can we give those guys a hand? Come on. That's awesome. Now listen to me, if you raised your hand on that, some of our leaders, they saw you. We're kind of like spies. We're like Russia. So we're spying on you and we're watching you. And so we're actually gonna come and approach you. We're gonna talk to you about the decision you made. It's not to embarrass you. It's only to encourage you. We are Jesus followers ourselves. And the Bible says, go into all the world and make disciples. It's not about actually churchgoers. It's about people, other people who are following Jesus. And so we're super glad that you made the decision. So we're gonna come talk to you afterwards. And other than that, love you guys. Thanks for coming.